Everything is always about her. At my core, I feel like I don't matter, that I am unlovable. She's fake. She's a fake bitch. She doesn't mean the things she says. It only matters what I do. It doesn't matter who I am. I don't know why I feel so driven to perfectionism. What is wrong with me? These are some of the most common statements of women who have moms with narcissistic PD. What I've noticed in my practice is that many women, often similar to borderline moms, have no idea their mom is a true narcissist, right? They think that she's self-absorbed, or they don't even think about their mom in terms of why are they so ashamed of themselves? Why are they so driven to perfectionism? Why do they have eating disorders? This is a very common dynamic with moms with narcissism, because so much of their experience is about the mother, and everything the children do is an expression of the mother. Now, let me say this as a parent, right? We do make connections with our kids. We do see them as some extension of us. If you're acting up in public, we, those of us, especially of a certain generation, think that it reflects on us and our parenting, and we want to teach you how to be respectful and appropriate. And so, yeah, certain things do reflect on us, but that doesn't make us a narcissist. A narcissistic mother makes everything about her and or really nothing about you, right? Because she could give a shit about what you're doing or who you are, what you need. It's all about her. So it depends on how it plays out. I'm going to make another video on what I think are the most common types of narcissist moms, especially using all of the new ones we talk about in terms of benign and communal and, you know, vulnerable and all of that, and grandiose. That'll be coming soon. So if you're just joining me, I'm Dr. Kim Sage. I'm a clinical psychologist, and this channel is hopefully evolving and morphing. I hope you will please feel free to comment down below and let me know what you want to know more about. But today's video is really about how to recognize a narcissistic mother and understand what that looks like. Because as I keep saying, people often surprisingly don't know. There's a huge community online discussing narcissism, which I think is awesome. But I do think that sometimes it's more nuanced. You know, the classic overt narcissists that we just expect to understand in terms of their over the top behavior, you know, those are easier to spot. But oftentimes people have traits, strong traits, or the disorder in these low-key kind of ways that can be really confusing for children as we grow up. And this channel is mostly for those of you who are in the process of growing up or grown up with parents who really struggled in some regard, most likely, and it has now affected your sense of self and your relationships, all right? So let's get started. Those are the most common statements, right? They're around, why am I a perfectionist? Why do I feel so worthless? Why do I have issues with my sense of self and self-esteem? My mom tends to be fake. She tends to be self-absorbed. Everything is about her. I never feel good enough. There's often a hatred towards the mother deep inside, although it's often a repressed hatred, because at the core, going back to attachment, these were parents who could never truly attune to their children, right? I couldn't mirror you back because it was all about me, getting my needs met, being sick, being the best, being not appreciated, whatever that is. And so we often see at the core a lack of empathy. There's a very low sense of self. And one thing I will say is if you have a mom like this, and this can kind of go for BPD and NPD, which do often overlap, but you might know you have a mom like this if when it comes to Mother's Day, you stand in the card aisle and you know that if you just get a card that says Happy Mother's Day, that's gonna make her upset. But then when you read through cards and they say too many nice things, but you have to say just enough nice things to not piss her off, that is often a sign, right? And so we'll see this attempt to always please her. And because we want our mother's light, we want to have her love and empathy, but narcissistic moms have a hard time doing that. So it depends on what kind of child you are. Are you the scapegoat? Are you the golden child? Are you the invisible child? And it depends on, does she have a more engulfing way of engaging where it's like everything you do is about her, or a more ignoring or neglecting where it's like you're on your own, you know, do your thing. And that will manifest in different ways. But the root of it is they cannot see you and mirror you because they're so self-absorbed in their own wounds, their own lack of empathy, and their own really low sense of self. Now, I found something that said that in one of the articles that said, one of the most common manifestations of narcissistic father or mother is the inability to be mindful of the child's own thoughts and feelings, like I was just saying, attuning, and validate them as real as important. Children under this type of parental influence over time may respond with one of three survival instincts. They may fight back and stand up for themselves. They may flight and distance from the parent, so they may flee. Some may begin to freeze and substitute their invalidated real self with a false persona, like playing the role they want you to be, and thus adopting the traits of narcissism themselves. Both types lack empathy, which is the cornerstone of narcissism. And I'm going to link some great books down below for maternal narcissism and narcissistic families down below. All right. And so the core of it is the parents always like everything that happens. It's why are you doing this to me? Right. That's the whole thing. It all comes back to me as opposed to the we of a family system. All right. So let's go through the signs that are most common with NPD moms. Right. So the first one is a lack of boundaries. This can be her talking about her life, her talking about your siblings, you know, not respecting your physical, mental, spiritual, emotional boundaries, walking around naked without a shirt on or not without clothes on. You know, it can be a true boundary push in many regards, because if I'm fine with being naked, you should be fine with being naked. It's this constant in-your-faceness of I do what I want to do, and you're really, you know, expectations for yourself don't matter. Now, with regard to walking around naked, let me just say this. I know that some cultures are more comfortable with that than others, and it depends on your child's age and things like that and your own belief system. So you do what you want to do. But I will say this. Once you have been naked with your kids and they're little, there's a point when it turns, when they begin to hold a gaze at you while you are not wearing clothes, whether it's you're changing or whatever. And once you begin to experience that gaze, that is usually the sign that it's time to maybe shift the boundary there. So that's a whole other video, but I will say that with those who have more of the PDs in general, there can be this around sexuality, over-sexualizing, or maybe being extremely protective sexually, but there's just this lack of flow and flexibility around boundaries that includes the body, the mind, and the soul, the emotions, mental health, and all of that. The next one is, of course, she's highly critical, perfectionistic, and controlling. She will tell you what's wrong with you. She will judge your outfit. She will rate what you're wearing. Nothing is ever good enough for her. And this can either be just for her or often for you too. The next one is she can be a guilt tripper and a manipulator and a controller. She often is trying to arrange life in a way that reflects well on her and really at anyone's expense. And so she will, you know, she will basically create situations where your feelings don't matter as long as she's getting her own needs met and creating this sort of narrative that she wants. Of course, we often see moms who have a very inflated sense of self and self-image. And, you know, I guess you could really think about Instagram moms and some of the housewives, not all of them, but we often see this sort of inflated sense of self. You know, no matter what's going on, it's about the outside. There is no real peering into the inside, allowing us to see what's going on. It's all the surface. The next one is she can call you names, just like we see with BPD in terms of, you know, you're a bitch or you don't look right. What's wrong with you? You're ugly. I can't believe you're wearing that. You know, things that normal parents should not be saying. And we all have our moments where we say it slips out. I'm not talking about that, you guys. I'm talking about a consistent attack on name calling. And I will say that if you are calling your child, you know, an asshole, a bitch, whatever, not okay. It's not okay. Don't tell me why it's okay. It's not okay. I'm not saying that every now and then we have these freak out moments and we get triggered. If that happens, you make a repair, you say you're sorry, but you should not be texting, calling your child really a name at all. It's very hurtful, but those with PDs, often borderline and narcissism, have no problem doing that. Or they're just low key guilt trippers and making you feel bad about yourself through the name calling. You're selfish, things like that. That's a favorite one, I think, for the PDs, especially towards children. And the ironic part is that she's the one who's selfish, right? So it always goes back to her no matter what's going on. The next one is love is conditional and confusing. So love is given as a conditional reward, not something that is just part of who you are and what you deserve. It's always given as a reward for giving that parent back whatever love, feelings, glamour, well-being, happiness, joy, success that they perceive that you are providing for them. And the flip side is that the way they give punishment is they withhold love. They're not there to help you. They're not there to love you. They're not available for you. They disengage and shut down and won't speak to you. I've heard of parents who didn't talk to their kids for months at a time living in their home. And so love is conditional, and love should not be conditional, especially as a child. Of course, you're an extension of her, and so everything you do reflects upon her. And the other part of that is that her need for this constant attention can be embarrassing. It's embarrassing, right? She will be somewhere needing to be the center of attention, whether it's, you know, in the office, at the PTA room, in the grocery store, in the family holiday. Everything comes back to her need. And I remember stories of clients who've talked about mothers who, you know, they'd be out somewhere and the mother just had to have all the attention, especially, let's say, in adolescence, when usually your teens begin to stand in the spotlight. They begin to get more attention physically. But for these moms, everything is a competition and they are determined to win at the sacrifice and expense of their own children. She can be jealous of you, of what you look like, of your friends, of your clothes. Of course, with boundary issues, she'll often take your clothes if she fits in your size. She has no problem competing with you and can't tolerate it when you are standing in the light. It needs to always be on her. And when it's not, of course, then we're going to see anger and rage, and that goes back to name calling and boundary violating. Whatever she needs to do to get her needs met, she will spare no expense, whether it's name calling. Some women can be physical and violent and dangerous. They can be abusive. I think that parenting with parents like this who have very poor self-control often leads to way more physical, and if at all, this shouldn't be happening, punishment for kids. And so this can be a dangerous place if she's in a rage. And of course, as a result of that, even if she's not, you know, physically abusive, she can be cruel and punishing, taking things away on purpose. You know, there's a difference between providing discipline and consequences and being cruel and punishing. Doing things that you know hurt your child's sense of self, their connection to others, their sense of safety, and their boundaries, whether they are, like I said before, you know, mental, physical, emotional boundaries. We know that at the core we have a lack of empathy and that they are not going to be there for us when we really need them. There's going to be this sort of shaming and blaming when we feel bad and we need their empathy. It's always about what we did wrong, what we didn't do enough, what we could do differently. And at the core, that's what they feel, but that's what they put onto their children. Now, because the outside matters, there's no expense spared, and so whether it's her house, her car, her sense of self, her job, her career, her degrees, you know, these can be women who are very driven to be, you know, CEOs and performance delivered. In fact, I think that a lot of people who are super successful often have some narcissistic traits because you almost have to have a false belief in yourself sometimes to take risks, to put yourself out there. And on some level, as long as you're not hurting people, I don't think that's necessarily a bad thing. But when we get into the real diagnosing and the real traits, it's really going to be at anyone's expense to get myself ahead. And so as a mom, if they're doing that, they can be neglecting you. They can be that more ignoring narcissist, right? They can be engulfing in that you're part of the team that have to make them successful, and you're part of the image and the Christmas card, and look at us, we're so awesome. I'm such a great mom. We see a lot of that, and I'll come back to that when I make the video on the types of moms. But the root of it is, I think she feels like this monster that consumes you, that is, there's never enough for her. She's just always trying to take control and make it about her, or ignore you and you're left to your own. At the end of the day, you do not feel attuned to, you don't feel that your needs matter, and everything is about her. And that really makes that sense of self and worthiness for you a deep wound that can be difficult to heal. Because at the core of it all, she is unable to change these behaviors and to take accountability for them, especially with narcissism, because they often don't come to therapy. They don't think they need therapy. They're doing just fine, thank you very much. And so it's really hard to create change. So the only person you can change is yourself. So if you grew up this way, if you're growing up this way, I hope you will get whatever help and resources you can. Lean into those who are safe, if you have other, you know, adults or peers that you can trust, and work on creating healthy relationships for yourself. Because, like always, if you grew up with a parent like this, it's very likely that even if you don't adopt the traits, which we often don't, but we can, but you could often, even if you don't, choose partners who are like that, right? We're always seeking a sense of safety and returning home. And sometimes home, in the beginning, like all relationships, when the honeymoon stage is on, looks great. But we wake up one day and realize we have married our mother or married our father, and we have recreated the same childhood trauma and a partner who will never be able to see us and give us what we want. And leaving a narcissist is one of the hardest things you will ever do, especially if it's a marriage and especially if kids are involved. So if you have not yet done that, I hope this channel will help you get some healing and some resources to start to do that. And if you're already in it, I hope you can get the support and help you need to work through those relationships, to leave those relationships, or to manage them depending upon your circumstances. All right, guys, I hope you enjoyed this video. Stick around. I'll be making more videos on narcissism too, and the types of narcissists, I believe, and what it does to us as children. And I hope you will, please feel free to post more about what videos you want. I just made a video around, please, give me your feedback and help me decide where to go next, because I'm trying to squeeze all these videos in. I'm going to edit less and hopefully make more content and produce more just to get more information out there and let go of my own perfectionism, which is part of my own childhood, but we're not going to discuss that. All right, guys, thank you so much. Have a good day, and I'll see you soon. Bye.